What's up, guys? Today, I'm going to be giving an in-depth guide on Mordor. Mordor is one of the more expensive heroes at 775 rubies, or 1,500 shards, but he has some of my favorite abilities and really rewards skill and knowledge about the game. Hopefully by the end of this video, I'll be able to give you guys a full understanding of all of his mechanics, and you'll be able to play confidently with decks of your own design. So let's start with the absolute basics and cover Mordor's basic attack and traits. Now his basic attack is unlike any other hero in the game. It hits absolutely everything on his side of the board, but only for 10 damage. The longer Mordor attacks, the faster his attack speed gets, increasing his DPS from 2.5 to a whopping 10 DPS to all targets on your side of the board. It takes him a while to increase his attack speed, so make sure that you keep it active when you can, and be cautious of any stuns, because once you stop attacking, you're going to have to start all over again to get that attack speed back up. As for talents, Mordor's first and second traits are the same. They both give you a tombstone. These are zero mana cost buildings that resurrect the next friendly minion that dies after they activate. They have 400 health each, and they take 10 seconds to activate, and they can reward you with some insane value if you time their activation properly. Imagine getting multiple cleavers or colossuses for zero mana. The value potential is insane. Be careful to watch out for any stuns on these buildings as well, as if they get stunned, they will have to spend another 10 seconds to reactivate. Mordor's third and final trait is Vengeful Dead. This is going to go ahead and give 50% movement speed and 50% attack speed to all minions resurrected by Tombstone. This helps reinforce your goal of getting big minions for free off your tombstones, as the slower hitting and moving minions will get far more out of this buff than any small minion will. That's not to say any small minion won't benefit from the effect. It is a sizable buff for everyone. Just I know when I play Mordor, I want those huge value minions coming out for free rather than a low cost minion. Alright, now that you know what Mordor's basic attack and traits are, I'm going to showcase a few different decks, all showing off a different aspect of what Mordor can really shine with. The first deck I will show will be one on the cheaper side, and show the absolute basic strategy when playing Mordor. If you just picked up Mordor and want to try him out but don't have the biggest collection, I definitely recommend trying out this deck. You can see we're going to be running double wall. The main reason that we're going to be doing this is because not only is it going to be a great defensive option, but as Mordor, we're going to allow more minions to come on our side so we can ramp up that attack speed. Plus, it's actually not a minion, and that's a huge benefit for us because it's going to be easier for us to land our tombstone on big high health minions like the blue golem in this deck. So we're going to start off by placing Plasmarines pretty early on just so we can get both of the bridges going on. And unfortunately, this is actually what you don't want to do, because you can see here our opponent is going to be able to get our minions on his side of the board. So when he puts his down, they still get a little bit more health left. And then in order for me to not get mana capped, I'm forced to play some additional Plasmarines, and they're going to start off with a little bit less health. So that small trade right there and that small weight is so crucial, because now he's already starting at a pretty good advantage, or at least he was until we fireballed his blood imps. But either way, the way that you start the match is so crucial. Make sure you're not just putting things out just because you have mana for it. Now here we're getting a lot of minions. I'm really excited about this game because I realize he's running a ton of low health minions. So I'm going to let him come in here, and basically Mordor's basic attack is going to take care of all of them here. I do have the tombstone down, so I'm going to put down my blue golem. I'm really excited to try to get that guy for free. Alright, and then you can see right here our opposing hero is now placing a ton of minions trying to stop this blue golem. And unfortunately, it is going to die, but it will get resurrected by the tombstone. It was able to get in a significant amount of damage to that opposing guardian. Our basic attack is going to finish off the rest of the damage on the guardian and help wipe up this push right here. And getting that blue golem off of that tombstone is going to make it so we have another push that we're getting essentially for free right here. We are going to shock rock so that guardian won't be able to shield all those blood imps. And we're at a very significant health advantage right now. We're also going to split up and put up a tombstone top lane for our next blue golem that's going to be coming out here in a second. We have a few other buildings that we can really capitalize as extra defensive tools while we're waiting for some mana. and we're going to play that to finish up the rest of the Blood Imps that were on our side of the board. Now you can see here Mordar's basic attack is fully ramped up, so these Blood Imps are not going to be able to get far onto our side of the board, and our opponent is going to take a significant amount of damage for that wave. All that damage that Mordar has spread across all those imps is all funneled down directly to our opponent hero. Now you can see here, we weren't able to get the blue golem out of the tombstone, but we were able to get an annihilator, and the annihilator is going to park perfectly behind our blue golem to get this really nice push going on. I don't believe our enemy opponent is going to be able to stop this push in any way. Just the amount of health on that blue golem is too great. We're going to fireball the rest of the blood imps, and that's going to be game. Alright, we're going to keep the trend going on with the Tombstone Madness, and our next deck is going to show how much damage you can trickle in by running triple Undying Skeletons. Ideally, everything here is just a ton of board presence. When it comes back, it gets significant amount of value, and it really doesn't matter what minion you're raising up with your tombstones in this deck. Now, I believe our opponent in this matchup is going to be playing one of the more common decks on the ladder right now. It's a deck type that essentially spams a lot of low-cost minions in order to have a really high uptime of a shield generator, or the shield totem. And our deck is actually a perfect counter to that, and more specifically, Blastmancer is the perfect counter to that, because Blastmancer is going to make it so whenever it kills a minion, it'll do damage to their entire side of the board. This is great at taking out huge swarms, but it's also great for taking out that totem and getting additional damage into the hero as well. So you can see here we killed the puff on top lane, and that was able to clear up the bottom lane puff as well. It's going to be able to showcase a lot more value than that in the future, but what's so great about this deck and having Blastmancer in it as well is while the Undying Skeletons go in and get a few extra hits in and then dying and then getting some more extra hits again in the future, the amount of trickle damage that will be completely combined with the Blastmancer and the Undying Skeleton should be enough to win you the game most of the time. Now you can see here there's that swirly bone animation right next to Apep, or our opposing master that we're going against right now. In a couple of seconds, some Undying Skeleton is going to pop up from there, and our Undying Skeletons that are just pushing through are going to die there as well. And the best part about playing Mordar with the Undying Skeleton is you have two chances to resurrect it, and then when you get the guy, he still has the ability to die and come back to life. So you're able to have this really sustained push going on for quite some time. It's one of my favorite decks to make sure that we're trickling in damage. So we are going to be placing the Blastmancer down here bottom lane. I want to stop this push that he's trying to play of a bunch of low-cost minions right here. Unfortunately, we are going to sustain a little bit of damage from the Demon Warrior, so I just want to hurry that up, put down a Undying Skeleton so that my Blastmancer can turn around. He was about to die, so I protected him with a Shock Rock. And now we got both lanes going on, a bunch of Undying Skeletons. All these guys are going to be able to push multiple times, and we're starting to get a significant amount of sustain going on. Now you can see here, he's still sitting at a fine amount of health, and that's going to happen for a good majority of the match. The main thing and the main strength about this deck is that you just keep trickling damage in, and there's not really any break from what you're doing. Now there's going to be a bunch of low-cost guys, and again, Blastmancer is just so good in this type of matchup, completely wiping up the board of anything that's too low health. The STINT bike is going to survive on top lane, but it's not too much of an issue right now. I'm more worried about dealing with these Demon Warriors bottom lane. Now the theme of the deck, again, is trickling in damage. We are also running a Beam of Doom, which is going to be great for single target removal. But when it gets to the point where you just need a little bit more damage on the hero, or a little bit more damage here and there, Beam of Doom is also a perfect spot for that as well. Alright, now watch this wave coming in right here. This is what's so great about Mordar, is now that his attack speed is so ramped up, all these low-cost cards are getting completely destroyed just by being on our side of the board. That's why that wall is so nice to have in so many different Mordar decks. It was also able to save us from that Demon Warrior by turning him around, and then Mordar just can take care of the rest for an entire side. It can be pretty insane. But we do have our tombstones going on right now, and we were able to get some Undying Skeletons up from that. These guys are going to be able to sustain an insane amount of push. They might die, it's fine, doesn't matter. Main thing with them is they come back, usually at a time when no minions there, and they're going to be able to get to the enemy hero and get some trickle damage in. Now, his Demon Warriors are now getting to the point where it's pretty scary, like none of them are dying anymore to Beam of Doom. So I'm going to try to delay as much as possible, try to get as much damage as I can get going on this side, try to protect a little bit by getting him down quickly with the Reboomer, and then having some minion to actually keep pushing down a lane. Now I am going to start developing a push for top lane rather than bottom. I do see that big scary Demon Warrior coming at me from below, but I do know that I have Beam of Doom coming around soon, so I'm just going to cycle my deck, try to get a really good push in going on, because I know a majority of the damage that I will end up dealing to the Demon Warrior will come from Beam of Doom. I know it can't kill it, I do have other options to deal with it, but I do want to make sure that I have some kind of push going on rather than completely turtling and not getting the value of this deck from trickle damage going on. So we are going to use a Reboomer to finish off the rest of his health. It's not ideal, but it's going to have to do right now. I do see that his Demon Warriors are getting absolutely scary here, so I just need to make sure I'm getting more bodies on top of the enemy hero. And you might see, even though he's got these big, really destructive Demon Warriors, our Undying Skeletons will be able to actually die and then slip past them to ensure that we're still going to be able to get some trickle damage in. All the while this is going on, we're still going to be able to put down our Blastmancer to cover up any type of puffs that might start developing, make sure that he's not healing too much, and also damage the hero little by little on top of that. Now it is a shame that he's going to use Shield Totem Protect against that Beam of Doom, but now I know that it's no longer readily available for him. So I see his health pool, I know I got that Blastmancer to get some additional trickle damage in on him, and I see a bunch of Undying Skeletons right underneath where the biggest Demon Warrior is right now. So I'm going to try to cycle to get back to Beam of Doom as quickly as possible, and the second I have enough mana, I'm going to plop it down, and this should be game. So even though it looked like we were going to completely die to this, and they had the biggest Demon Warriors ever, turns out that little bit of trickle damage really carried the game for us. Now let's get to the final and my favorite deck for the day. This one takes advantage of Mordor's strong basic attack when used in combination with the wall, and takes advantage of the tombstones to ensure that you will always have your combo pieces and win condition. This deck is like some that I've shown previously, where you just try to buff up a really strong Soul Stealer and then you enrage it. But this one has much more defensive capabilities than any other ones that I've shown. This version is not as weak to Lightning Bolt, since it has many additional buildings that can take the hit instead of the Soul Stealer, and only two minions, so the Spirit Infusions will always land on the minions we need them to. Now unfortunately we're not starting this game with Soul Stealer, we just have one minion to start out with, and the Spirit Mancer is not going to be able to benefit off of its own minions it kills. So this guy's just going to be trying to trickle in damage and taking the bridge until we can finally get the combo going on later game. Now again, this deck is almost entirely building, so the main source that you're going to have for DPS early on is by doing a wall like this and doing Ghost Turret afterwards, and you're going to have to sustain a bit of damage at the beginning just to group everything up. Your hero doesn't have to take it specifically in case you're going to rush deck, you can go ahead and put out your walls. But you do need to make sure that they're on your board for a decent portion as you try to start and set up that Soul Stealer. But you can see here, since we have no other minion, our Soul Stealer just got on the board, and a fireball is going to hit him. He's going to take barely any damage from that, and this guy's just going to get stronger, more insane, and he's going to be able to win the game by himself at this point. He is an absolute behemoth. We can go ahead and put down Spirit Mancer as well as needed, and that Spirit Mancer is just going to keep healing up the Soul Stealer. We can keep cycling through using buildings defensively, and then putting all of our Spirit Infusions directly onto this one guy. He's even going to be able to, I don't want to spoil it, but look at how much damage he's doing to that living statue. He's going to be able to take it by himself while he's being attacked by other minions. And even though he's been on the board this entire time, his health pool is still pretty insane, and we're going to be able to just keep throwing on more health onto him. We're going to be able to keep healing him up, and he should be able to win the game here now that he's completely left alone. There was a little bit of a push going on top lane. We were able to stop it with a wall. Again, our ghost turret just does so much damage that we really don't have to have so much more on our side. We can just get a bunch of damage through just walls and Mordor's basic attack and then ghost turrets as well. But you can see here, as Soul Stealer is an absolute beast. There's nothing they can do about it here, and that's gonna win us the game. Alright, that's gonna be all the decks and games I have for you guys today. I hope I was able to teach you the basics of Mordor and showcase some different decks that all highlighted a different strategy that you can do with Mordor. If you're already a pro and you got a strategy for Mordor that I didn't cover in this video, feel free to leave your strategy in the comments down below. If you enjoyed the video, feel free to leave a like, and to stay up to date with all of my videos, you can hit that subscribe button as well. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you guys next time.